Okay, but I want to just challenge you with, you know, because there's a lot of good points that we have been studying in this lesson. If you continue to read it and absorb the information, you're going to come up with a whole lot of things that could really help you to watch your business, your ministry, whatever God has called you to do. Because everything that's going to happen is going to happen by faith. It's going to be by faith. And it's very befitting because the evangelist, which is coming Sunday, he taught several years at Rhema. And one of the courses he taught several, but one of them was the authority of, submission and authority. That was one, but he taught a lot of faith courses. So it's going to really put a lot of emphasis on some of the things that we have gone over. I'm going to ask a little later on how you felt about the points that we made concerning the different things that will elevate your belief or will expand your believing that we mentioned. Number one was environment. We're going to be the product of our environment. Our belief is going to be impacted by the environment that we have been exposed to. And so this is very important, how the four things that we studied that shape your belief starts with the environment. And we mentioned several things about the environment. Then the second thing would be credible people and authority figures around us. Mm-hmm. People that fed us information, teachers and preachers and leaders and parents and relatives that we considered credible, people that we felt like they knew what they were talking about. We kind of fed on whatever they told us. And sometimes it was false information. They didn't intentionally do it, but yet it was error, and we're going to be impacted by credible authorities that we receive information from in our early childhood and throughout our lives. Number three was repetitious information. Anything that you are fed over and over again with, anything you hear continuously, that's one of the reasons why people like to listen to tapes or CDs and DVDs teachings, because they have to hear that over and over and over and over. Sometimes we've heard that at least 50 times before that really begins to get ingrained in your subconscious mind. So you have to hear things over and over and over and over before you can really unpack you. All right, that's three things. We mentioned environment, credible people, and authority. On page four, repetitious information, and life experiences. All right, life experiences perhaps is the one that probably impacts us more than all of the others. Okay, life, whatever you experience in life, you can understand that because things that you have gone through and emerged victoriously, mm-hmm. you're going to be controlled by that experience. You say, well, I know God is going to come through because, you know, 5 years ago, 10 years ago, I was facing some real difficult hardships. And I prayed, I stood on the word, and lo and behold, God turned the circumstance around. You remember that, and that will be a point of reference when you're facing something in the future that's really difficult. So it takes your belief up to another level. When you face something in reality and you go through it and emerge victoriously, it really brings your belief to a higher level. So there's nothing that will impact you more than the actual experience, the natural experience, but it doesn't have to always be a natural experience that you encounter that will impact your faith. It can be a a soulish experience. It can be a soulish experience. That will impact you and really have a tremendous impact on how you feel, how you think, and how you respond. For instance, like, how many ever had a dream, a good dream? How many had a good dream? I mean, you're going to be impacted. For instance, who was that? Joseph. He had a dream, right?
Amen.
When he was a young kid, he had all of these dreams. And in these dreams, he saw himself as what? Coming out on what? Top and having control and authority over what? Everybody. Everybody bowing down to him. And that guided him all through his life. You know, from the 18, I believe at the age of 18, when he was sold into captivity and started working under Potiphar. I think it was 12 years until he was 30. But all of those bad experiences that he went through, even he ended up landing up in prison. Right? Amen. Lied on by who? Potiphar's what? Wife. And remember, he had a very positive attitude because under the leadership of Potiphar, the Bible says that everything that he put his hands to, everything that he did for Potiphar, God caused it to what?
Prosper,
right? And so Potiphar and all of these people that were connected with him in that, you know, household, they knew that Joseph was what? He was blessed of God. They knew the favor of God was on Joseph. They knew it. So you can see that after Potiphar's wife messed up a good thing, he landed up in what? Prison. You know, seemed like he would have been so frustrated, so disturbed, ready to what? Give up, throw in the towel. How many probably would have thrown it in? All right, but it was something that sustained him all through all of these what, adversities and trials and difficult times. When he was out there all alone, separated from his family, didn't have a clue as to how his family was faring. I mean, that was a hard experience, but I think the thing that sustained him was the what? That soulless experience, that dream. So dreams and visions and things of that nature we call soulless experiences. And when you can see something, see a vision, see a dream, experience a dream, that thing will have a lasting what? Impact on you. And you're going to be guided and controlled by that what? By that experience. You're going to be guided and controlled by that experience. Let me see. I had some special notes here. Page 14. See, when you can see a vision or a dream and have a soulless experience and God shows you something, it could even be a revelation knowledge as you get through meditation. But what happens is that God enables you to see the end results of whatever you are going through or you believing for or whatever predicament or situation. You can see the end result. And if you can see the end result, it really eliminates a whole lot of what? Anxiety and frustration. And so I'm just trying to emphasize the importance of an experience. So I'm getting at something, but an experience will have more, it has more ability to elevate your belief and to cause you to expand your capability of believing than any other exposure you have had, which includes environment. I don't care how negative people have taught you and you know, the negative mindset that you picked up from people that were supposed to be incredible authorities. You can reverse all of that because life experiences are designed to reverse any type of unwholesome form of believing that you have ever, amen, developed through being exposure to these three different components. Okay, now on page 14, you said, it's God's will for a man to see the end results from the beginning. Seeing the end results from the beginning will serve as a compass for your life. See, that's what happened to Joseph. Even all through those horrible experiences, those 30-some years where God was bringing him from the pit, they had thrown him in the pit, to the highest position in Egypt. But the thing that sustained him, he always saw this picture in his mind that he was what? One day was going to what? Be on top, and he was going to be telling everybody else what to do. And everybody was going to be bowing down to him. He had that dream. All right. I know that some of us have, you know, we might have some turnip green, fat meat and turnip green dreams. but dreams will impact you. Whatever you dream, people will sometimes call me. Can you tell me what this means? They ate too much, ate the roses. But there are some dreams, you know, and visions that God can give you that really are designed to elevate your belief. And these things will serve as a compass throughout your life. I don't care what happens, what comes, or what doesn't happen. Amen. You're going to what? You're going to stay focused, just like I'm getting ready to read here. It eliminates frustrations, which we can become preoccupied when in the present. It eliminates frustration, which we can become preoccupied with in the present. You know, when frustrations come, if you get caught up in that, amen, it can what? It can really get you what? Frustrated. That's the reason why you're going to have to what? See the end, you know, and we have a perfect way of seeing the end from the beginning. Amen, through the next point that we're going to make, because we just mentioned that you have a natural experience, you can have a soulish experience, and then you can have a spiritual experience, and that involves the meditation, the prayer, how God can just show you more on your knees and through the Word than a person. I often say that God can show you more on your knees then you can see tiptoeing, standing up. He can show you more on your knees. Amen. And many times through meditation. Meditation is a very powerful experience, but we just don't want to look at meditation as just being, mulling over the Word. You know, sometimes we just read silently, reflect on the Word, and we consider that as the ultimate in meditation, but that's not. Meditation is a series of things that you do in order to get the Word deeply implanted into your heart. And it's a process. And we're going to talk about those three components which meditation involve in this particular section that starts on page 14. All right, now let's look at number 6. It said eliminates frustrations which we can become preoccupied with in the present. You can see the end results of what God promised. It gives you purpose and focus in the now. It keeps you on track. Okay, now that's the thing that, you know, all of us got stories that we can tell. I imagine Marianne can, you know, she has a business. Brother Williams has a business. And the thing that keeps you from getting off track, giving up, giving in, throwing in the towel, is that you are seeing the end results sometimes through attending meetings where you've had people that have excelled and they have worked themselves up to six-figure incomes and sometimes seven and eight-figure incomes. You've seen things like that materialize, you know, right before your eyes. And these things impact you when you hear about people that have gone through those types of experiences. It helps to keep you on track. And you know, if you follow the same same principles and all of the things that it takes for you to succeed in that particular business, it's kind of easy for you to see yourself with a six-figure income as well. So, you know, Sister Hill always said this. She says, if you can't see it before you see it, you'll never see it. Right? Whatever your heart can, what? Whatever your mind can, what? conceive and what believe, you can always achieve it. But it has to be some type of vision or dream or some type of a picture or image that you get from information that you have heard that really gives you the ability to see the end results before the beginning. So now the thing that personally, you know, I've been pastoring here for 30-some years, and you know, sometimes you look at conditions when we first started or years ago, you know, it was much different. You know, we had a lot more people. We had, you know, a whole lot of things going, and it's kind of easy for you to say at this point, you say, well, you know, we're not what we used to be, and a whole lot of the people that helped out years ago are gone, and, you know, they're doing various things. So people come in now, you know, if they see, you know, maybe 15 or 20 or 30 people, they don't sign it, they say, ain't nothing happening here. You know, and sometimes that is a real challenge because people will judge you on what they see what now. They don't know about all of the people that have come out of this ministry, and they don't know about the word, how it has been built into you, although we might be few in number. But I've heard a whole lot of people from bigger ministries say that there is a depth or spirit of prayer and the word and a commitment found in you that far exceeds people that comes from a whole lot of the big ministries. And I'm telling you, some of these people from these big ministries, they'll trip if you ever see one. I can't share with you things I know and the things I've been through. And sometimes I'm just happy just to be around a few people that have, amen, have some respect and fear of God, reverence for God. That makes me feel really, really privileged. But I have to see far beyond what I see tonight. And so that enables me to keep going, I'd be motivated. And, you know, I can see a whole lot that I don't in the natural. And I feel that all of my bad experiences and hardships and frustrations have all worked together for the good. Mm-hmm. Amen. Some things that I can do now, I have expertise in now, that amen, I wouldn't trade nothing for. Mm-hmm. So, you know, in your golden years, you can do a whole lot. Is that right? All right, so that's what I'm saying here, point two. It gives you purpose and focus in the now. It keeps you on track. It will be easy for me to say, well, I ain't big